you got to keep your eyes on Jesus this year. And it's important that you be careful about who you hang out with this year. Because everybody you hang out with is not going in the same direction in which you are going in. I know you love him. We've been friends for quite some time. But even when Jesus got ready to cross over to the other side, he had to dismiss the crowd. And even some of the disciples didn't believe that they could walk on water. It was only Peter himself that began to get out of the boat. This year you got to be a water walker. You got to step out on faith and know that God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you can ask or think. For with God I am a champion. With God I can do all things. Through Christ that strengthens me, I am more than a conqueror. Through Christ Jesus, from the youngest to the eldest, you gotta claim your healing. You gotta speak life over yourself and say that by his stripes I am healed in the name of Jesus. No longer will I have sleepless nights. No longer will I have restless nights. Not over this anymore, but this shall come to an end. Ecclesiastes declares that there is a time and a season for everything up under the heaven. This is the time and the season in which you must come out from amongst them and be ye separated and be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Get your mind back this year. Take your mind back from the enemy. No longer will you have suicidal thoughts. No longer will you be a parent that gives up on your children. But there is power in you. And I dare you to begin to plead the blood over your kids. And watch something happen. There's power in the name of Jesus. Some of you have forgotten the old time tradition. What prayer can't do can't be done. And if you ever get down on your knees and begin to plead the blood of Jesus, look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, the blood still works. I need somebody that still believe that. When you go back to your school, plead the blood of Jesus. When you go back on your job, plead the blood of Jesus. When you walk back up in your house, plead the blood of Jesus. Cancer's got to go. Diagnosis got to go. Grades have got to turn around. Your situation has got to change. You are born to be successful. You shall overcome. This is not the end for you. You shall live and not die.
My God, one time, one thing you can thank him for is that you're one of the chosen. Because some folk would have given up by now. But I came here to tell you, my brothers and sisters, that weeping may endure for a night. But joy comes in the morning. And can I tell you that just not by happenstance that you came up in here on today. Everybody is here for a certain purpose. God sent you here to this corner, to this church today, so that you can hear what thus saith the Lord for your right now situation. And I don't know who I'm talking to, but young lady, young man, lift up your head. Oh, ye gates, be lifted up the everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty. Who is the King of glory? The Lord mighty in battle. No devils better watch out. Folk that's talking about you better watch out. Everybody that's trying to keep you from getting to your goal better watch out. Because the King is on his way.
Yes.
And when the King comes back, demons triple. Mountains got to be moved. Sickness has got to go. Diseases have got to be set free. In the name of Jesus, if you believe that, clap those hands and give God praise in this. Young David tending the sheep, a man after God's own heart, one that had found favor with God, didn't mean any harm, just being a servant. and yet hated and envied by so many people. One that was doing simply what he was asked to do. A young man who they had set up to kill on many occasions. You ain't going through nothing that the Bible don't talk about. And I don't know if that'll help you. But the Bible talks about everything that we're dealing with in these last days and times. Understand, beloved, that David had his flaws. David had a woman issue. Yes, he did. But yet he was honest with God. He asked God daily to create in him a clean heart and renew within him a right spirit. This year, beloved, don't you feel guilty. Just stay honest with God and he'll bless you. Let him know that this is what you're dealing with and you're striving to come out of it. This is why David was blessed. But they didn't understand that. David was the one who had defeated Goliath with a slingshot. The one who was hated. And he was hated by King Saul at the time, who was jealous of him. Some of you and I are like David. You have helped folk. You have took care of people. You have befriended people. Only for them to turn around and stab you in the back. You got co-workers hating on you. Just because you're doing your job well. And all you're doing is being yourself. All you're doing is doing you. But doing you works. And they can't do nothing with the favor of God that is upon your life. Look at somebody and say, favor ain't fair. I'm one of the chosen. He just likes me like that. I can't help it. That whatever I put my hands to, it is successful. I can't help it. That I've been endowed with the wisdom and knowledge in which God has ordained in me from birth. I can't help it. That I'm gifted. I can't help it. That I'm anointed. That God has blessed me with these things. So lift up your hand. It ain't your fault that you anointed. It ain't your fault that you blessed like you blessed. It ain't your fault that things happen when you get in the midst of it. It ain't your fault. It's just the favor of God that is upon in your life. Here we see in the 29th chapter, before chapter 30, where the Philistines, who were just with David, getting ready to fight this battle, they turn on David. Mind you, they themselves said that they found no fault in David. You can read it on your private study time. I don't have time to walk through this thing. But they themselves said that they found no fault in him. They couldn't even give a legit or adequate reason, my brothers and sisters, why they didn't want David around anymore. Some of you are like David. You've been outcasted. You've been the one who everybody talks about because you don't agree with everything that goes on, because you're not like everyone else. You're uncommon. You're unordinary. You're a peculiar. You are unique. And folk can't stand to see that. And so they begin to cast David out. My God, mind you, they also make sure to mention that Saul slayed his thousands and David his 10,000s. Isn't it good to know, beloved, that you are a threat to the kingdom? David was a threat to the kingdom. Be not dismayed, beloved, that whatever betide you, God will take care of you. Romans 8 and 18 declares, for I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. Hebrews chapter 12 verse 2 declares, looking unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Understand, people of God, that you got to go through this. This is something you got to endure if you're going to go higher in God. I've got to be crushed. I've got to be broken. I've got to be ridiculed. I've got to be misused. I've got to go through the storm. I've got to go through the fire. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. But when God closer to my destiny. And every time I want to give up, God says, keep going a little bit further. Every time I want to throw in the towel, God says, keep going a little bit further. Because your worst days are more are behind you. And your better days are ahead of you. We got somebody that said, you ain't seen nothing yet. You ain't seen nothing yet. I may not look like anything right now, but you ain't seen nothing yet. When I come out of this thing, I'm going to be stronger. I'm going to be wiser. I'm going to be better. Because I am getting it back this year. At this point now, David is down and discouraged, trying to figure out what he had done. And really, he had done nothing but something. And the something was just doing what he does. And in doing what he does, created envy, because the enemy knows and sees God's chosen and anointed. It's not by happy chance that folk around you are that folk that you hang out with. They see where you're headed. They see the potential in you. They see, and even some family sometimes can be hating on you and be jealous of you. I can't get no real folk up in here. Even the ones closest to you are usually the ones that turn on you and begin to hate on you. When they see your future, when they see the potential, when they see the entrepreneurship in you, when they see the business owner, when they see the doctor, the lawyer, when they see you graduating and getting your degree, when they see that your future is brighter than your yesterday, they begin to try and throw thoughts in your path. My God, but can I tell you on today that there is hope for you? So David and his men, after being sent away, rose up early in the morning, only to return to the city in which had been invaded by the Amalekites. The city had been burnt up, and their families had been taken captive, and everything that they had was gone. Everything they had was gone. Everything. Can you imagine waking up and returning home and everything is burnt up and gone? Can you imagine waking up in the morning and you going back to your house and everything is burnt up and gone? Your wives and your husbands have been taken captive. Your children have been taken captive. All your property, all your stuff is gone. The car is gone. The house is gone. My God, everything that you have is gone. Now, in reality, in the fleshly part of our being, it would be a natural reaction in the fleshly part of our being. In our fleshly part of our being, it would be a natural reaction to want to get even and lose hope. And in our natural reaction, in our fleshly being, it would be a natural reaction, if we be real, to want to cuss and fuss and weep and even begin to turn on each other in our natural fleshly reaction. But in all this, David didn't do none of this. He didn't do none of the above. Mind you, the text says that David was greatly distressed. He was mad. He was angry, wondering what in the world is going on. And some of you are right here where David was in your life right now. You're wondering what in the world is going on. Why is this happening to me? Lord,